We are at the last Wednesday night of the youth group year here in 2021. It's been a difficult year, but not as much as 2020 was, obviously. We've had a great year in London First Baptist Youth Group. We've had a tremendous summer, a tremendous fall, had a great wrap-up to the year with our series in Ecclesiastes and with our Christmas party last week and just seeing some cool stuff happen. And so our last week, we're going to do another Christmas message, just kind of a light Wednesday night or whatever across the board, but we're going to hit the Christmas story hard again. So we are in Matthew 1, 18 through 25 and Luke 1, 26 through 38. And we're talking about how God used an ordinary couple. They were willing to trust and obey to bring the Messiah into the world, and how he wants the same for us, and how the message of Christmas is a message of hope. If I were to give you a gift box, if I had a gift box in my hands and said, who wants this gift? How many of you would take it? No questions asked. What if I said, if you accept this gift, it's going to change the direction of your life. It's going to alter things in your life. It may make you an outcast. It may give you heartache and disappointment. That's basically what happened to Mary. That's comparable to what Mary went through. So would you still want it? That's what happened in Mary's life. Matthew 1, we see Joseph's part of the story first, and then in Luke we see Mary's part. Matthew 1, the birth of Jesus Christ came about this way. After his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, it was discovered before they came together that she was pregnant from the Holy Spirit. So her husband Joseph, being a righteous man, not wanting to disgrace her publicly, decided to divorce her secretly. But after he had considered these things, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. What has been conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. See, the virgin will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and they will name him Emmanuel, which is translated, God is with us. When Joseph woke up, he did as the Lord's angel had commanded him. He married her, but did not have sexual relations with her until she gave birth to a son, and she named him Jesus. So there's Joseph's side of the story. Here's Mary's side, and we're actually going to start with Mary's side when we get into the teaching time in just a second, but I'm reading them in the order that they are in the Bible. Luke 1, 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and the angel came to her and said, greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you. But she was deeply troubled by this statement, wondering what kind of greeting this could be. Then the angel told her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Now listen, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end. Mary asked the angel, how can this be, since I have not had sexual relations with a man? The angel replied to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Consider your relative Elizabeth. Even she has conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month for her who is called childless, for nothing will be impossible with God. I am the Lord's servant, said Mary. May it be done to me according to your word. Then the angel left her. So let's talk about Mary's trust first and foremost. I know we read Joseph first, and really probably should have read Mary first, but I was just reading it in the order it's in. Mary's trust. She couldn't have understood what was going on completely. She couldn't have understood what was about to happen in her life. Everything was about to be uprooted. God was choosing her. God was gifting her with the privilege of carrying his son into the world. And it says she was greatly troubled. And to that I say, duh, I would be too. Put yourself in her shoes. It seems obvious that she would be confused, that she'd be fearful, that she'd be afraid, that she wouldn't know what to do with it initially. She's chosen by God. She's given his presence to lead her through it all. And her role is to accept it and obey it, but she couldn't have understood it completely. She also realized that things were about to get hard. She moved from afraid to perplexed to curious to confused. She knew she hadn't had sex. How could she have a baby? It's not possible, right? And then even if it was, how do I explain it to other people? How do I try to convince those other people in my life? Try to explain angel visits. Try to explain a virgin birth. What would people say? What would they think? How would they treat her? How would they treat Jesus? She hadn't planned on being pregnant yet, and all of a sudden she is. And so things are going to get difficult a lot sooner than expected. But she trusted and obeyed. Gabriel, the angel, encouraged Mary to trust God's power. And her faith, her response rather, shows faith and surrender. It wasn't begrudging obedience, it was joyous surrender. She was happy to obey. She would trust God, and his presence would carry her through the whole experience. And she would accept God's plan, even if it didn't make sense, even if she didn't totally understand it. She obeyed and trusted and moved forward regardless. even when it was difficult to grasp. Without fully comprehending what was going on, without fully comprehending God's plan, we can trust and embrace it anyway. Second thing I want to talk about is Joseph's obedience. How many of you guys are planners? How far ahead do you plan? How do you feel when your plans get disrupted? Because that's what's going on here for them. Joseph had doubts and fears. Put yourself in his shoes. Your fiance comes up pregnant. Mary's pregnant. He's confused. He's struggled. His wife's pregnant, but he knows that the baby is not his. Legally, he could have put her to death or at least publicly disgraced her. He was torn. He loved Mary and didn't want to embarrass her, but he also had his own reputation. This is unacceptable. This is embarrassing. This is something difficult to deal with. He's going to have to quietly put her away, trying to avoid as much humiliation, as much public humiliation anyway, as possible for both of them. He was a righteous man, but he still had doubts and fears. He's not a perfect man. Second thing, his whole world changed. How do you feel about change? A lot of people don't like it. We don't know much about Joseph, but I'm sure he had things planned out. A life with Mary, a career, things like that, a family. But the events of Christmas must have changed that a lot, must have changed things for him a whole lot. And the angel explained that Jesus would be the Messiah, that Mary had been supernaturally impregnated, and that they would raise the Son of God. And Joseph was beginning to see what this disruption was all about. So he surrendered to God's plans. When he woke up from the dream, he aligned his life with God's plan, as revealed in the dream. He obeyed, even though it couldn't have made a lot of sense. He's committed to obeying God, and he would obey now, too, even though it's difficult, even though it's hard to understand. He didn't ask for time to think about it. He didn't put it off. He didn't pray about it. Even though God altered his plans dramatically, Joseph obeyed faithfully. He played a key role in the birth and in the early life of Jesus the Messiah, and he shows us the value of obeying God immediately. So he surrenders to God's plan. The last thing I want us to talk about in our time together here is the hope of Christmas. Christmas is hope. Jesus brings hope through anything that life brings. Sometimes that's all we have. Romans has a passage that says that alone is worth celebrating. If that's all we have, if we have hope. If we find ourselves in a troubled time, the life of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Christ gives us the gift of hope. It's never too late for things to turn around. So we should remain patient. We should prayerfully trust God and believe that he'll come through and wait on him. God's paying attention. He sees. He knows. He's going to turn things around. We can trust that he's there. We can trust that he's listening, that he's loving, that he's wanting us to turn it around. Jesus brings hope through anything life brings. He also brings hope when life seems hard to understand. For thousands of years, the Hebrew people had believed the Messiah was coming. One day he was going to rescue, but God had gotten silent, and they didn't understand everything. But they were certain that God would not fail them, that he would not forsake them. Though the timing wasn't what they expected, and the way it happened was not what they expected, not what they would have preferred, Jesus fulfilled these promises they had waited for so long. Sometimes you can't see the presence of Jesus in your life at the moment, but keep faith. Keep believing. Keep believing he'll come through even when you don't understand what's going on. And finally, Christmas means God is with us. One of the names given to Jesus was Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. The angel gave this as a name for Jesus and as a reminder of the presence of God always around us, always available. That should comfort us. This idea should comfort us as we realize we're never alone, as we realize that we have God that we can always call on, that we can always count on. Christmas offers the world the greatest gift that there is, salvation. The name Jesus means the Lord saves. It's closely related to the word Joshua. It means the Lord saves. Jesus came for our salvation. God, he came as God's greatest gift for us. And at the heart of the Christmas season is a hope, a deep sense of hope for what can be. As we celebrate the birth of our Savior, as we celebrate the Christmas season, we have reason to celebrate. We have hope that things can change too, even in times like we're living in right now. So what needs to happen for you this year? Do you need to nail down your salvation? Do you need to come back to him because you've wandered from him? Do you need to just pause and be grateful for what God has done for you and the hope that you have because of Jesus? Do you need to give yourself wholeheartedly to following his plan, no matter what it is, no matter how hard it might seem, no matter how confusing it might seem, since he gave everything for you? Whatever needs to happen, the invitation this year is to say yes to him, to let him have you completely this Christmas.